taking its place alongside photography, sound, acting, editing, writing, and directing as part of the language of film. The job of the visual effects designer is to create believable imagery to complement improbable story requirements. And the tools needed include an understanding of the physical sciences, a willingness to experiment, and a thorough knowledge of what's gone before. Photographic effects supervisor for the Star Wars series, Richard Edlund.
In visual effects, there are many techniques available to us, and some of these techniques go back to 1902. We've added electronic technology and the golden age of optics and very fancy camera mechanics, not to mention clothespins, chewing gum, and baling wire to all of those techniques. We're not proud. In other words, if we see something that's an ancient technique, why not use it if it works?
Visual effects served the same purpose at the turn of the century as they do now. They were a way for audiences to see sights that were too expensive, dangerous, or fantastic to shoot live on location. And as you can see from this recreation of the 1898 Battle of Manila Bay, generally considered to be the first miniature effect shot, then as now, the simplest way to achieve the effect was usually the best. These days, the modern visual effects studio may employ hundreds of technicians at full clip, each lending his or her expertise to the mammoth task of realizing a fantasy feature film on time and on budget. Apogee Incorporated in Los Angeles was originally established to produce the effects for the first Star Wars film. They've since created shots for Battlestar Galactica, Firefox, Star Trek, and this production, Life Force. Apogee Incorporated is a direct descendant of this small company in turn of the century France. It was the world's first fully realized visual effects studio, built and operated by the first master of fantasy filmmaking, Georges Méliès. By the end of the last century, moving pictures have become the most popular element of most stage magic shows. In fact, audiences were beginning to complain about the magicians getting in the way of the real entertainment. Méliès was the first to take the hint. He began by transferring his stage tricks to film, quickly realizing ways to trick the camera as easily as he could fool an audience. The diversionary stage tactics became simple tricks of time and space, achieved by stopping the camera just long enough to effect whatever change was needed. Méliès knew that film responded only to light, and used this knowledge to re-photograph the same sequences over and over, always placing himself in a different area of the darkened and therefore unexposed stage. And, as we'll soon see, these early solutions form the basis of many of the multiple compositing and animation processes in use today. Like the Battle of Manila Bay footage we saw earlier, animation could show us scenes no news camera could match, such as these wartime images of the sinking of the Lusitania. The artist responsible for this newsreel had achieved a sizable reputation a few years earlier with his animated account, The Dream of the Werebit Fiend. Winsor McCay had been a popular newspaper cartoonist who was fond of billing himself as the inventor of animated drawing. He was also no stranger to the lure of the live stage when, in 1911, he decided to accept a challenge to animate a dinosaur and perform alongside it. 10,000 drawings later, this rather whimsical brontosaurus named Gertie was born. She was the first step towards the ultimate goal of linking animation and live action on film, a goal that was finally achieved by another well-known cartoonist, Max Fleischer. The creator of Popeye and Betty Boop, Fleischer called his new process rotoscoping, and it allowed the animator to trace over a projected image and then re-photograph the new artwork. This dancing clown is an early example. He used to be a dancing man until his image was retraced in the rotoscoping process. A number of animators made use of it in the 20s and 30s, including Walt Disney for this excerpt from his Alice series. Today, the technique is used to enhance live-action photography, and subtle touches like light and shadow effects, as well as ray blasts and lightsabers, have made rotoscoping the main activity of Visual Concepts Engineering, a Los Angeles company headed by Peter Curran.
I actually started in this business working on the first Star Wars. That's where I'd gotten my first job. And when people talk about rotoscoping being a sweetening of images, I'm very glad that my initial beginnings in the film industry were in the rotoscope area, because rotoscoping is used to fix a multitude of sins. And without that type of experience, you can't really go into a project where you require a lot of visual effects and not have the knowledge of exactly how rotoscoping can help fix something. The technique of rotoscoping itself is just basically where you're using a motion picture camera to act as a projector and a camera at the same time. If you project an image out of a motion picture camera onto a piece of paper, draw that image, outline it, and then shoot it back through the same camera, which is through the same lens and through the same setup without moving the camera, you basically wind up with artwork at the same position. I would like to think that my company is one of the lowest tech in the business.
There was a time when it would have been nearly impossible to break through studio security and learn the tricks of the visual effects trade. California publisher Don Shea's quarterly trade publication, Cinefex, is just one reflection of the new public interest in this highly technical craft. In fact, busy filmmakers have frequently used the publication as a means of keeping up with each other's newest achievements. One of Shea's main areas of interest lies in detailing the early history of one of the most difficult of all effects techniques, three-dimensional or stop-motion animation. Stop-motion animation evolved out of the same theory as cartoon animation, that of stopping the camera to make minute changes between frames. Unlike the earlier method, though, stop-motion animation could frequently be played out on a much larger canvas, and, as we can see in this early example called Moving Day, with considerably heavier props. On a more intimate level, it was a perfect technique to mix with other effects to create ever more complex shots. This 1927 Russian film entitled Song of the Nightingale combines both two- and three-dimensional animation with rotoscoping and a colorization process that required the hand tinting of every frame of film. At the same time in North America, a skillful combination of stop motion and rear projected live action was helping to secure the reputation of a seasoned animator named Willis O'Brien. Spurred on by his success with the 1927 film The Lost World, O'Brien decided to experiment further. His next venture was a test film called Creation, and although it would never be turned into the feature he'd planned on, it would lead directly to the greatest fantasy epic of the age.
Marion C. Cooper, who was brought in as a consultant at RKO at the time, looked at this footage and kind of nixed the project from a story point of view. But at that point, Willis O'Brien and Byron Crabb, a painter who was working on the show, came up with this painting here, which depicted a giant ape in a jungle setting, and managed to convince Cooper that he could do an ape picture, which he was trying to do as a live action picture, with animation in the studio, and that's how King Kong was born.
Kong was released in 1933 to unanimous public acclaim. It was the first great merging of all known effects techniques, and it stood as an inspiration to generations of filmmakers and fans alike.
The Discovery Channel.
In the early years of commercial filmmaking, effects were generally used sparingly, more to enhance reality than radically alter it. One reason for this was that early effects had to be done on set in the camera and right on the precious original negative. There was very little margin for error when the studio's budget was at risk. It was becoming obvious that if the filmmaker's imagination was to remain unchecked, a tool was needed that could assemble various picture elements into startling new combinations. And in the late 1920s, the machine everyone had been waiting for was born. American engineer Linwood Dunn called it the Acme Dunn optical printer, the world's first commercially practical rephotographing camera. The theory was simple. A beam of light shines through one piece of film, perhaps the painted portion of a matte shot. It then carries on to illuminate a second film element that's placed exactly in line with the first. This may be a live-action portion of the frame. The combined elements are then re-photographed onto a fresh piece of film. Precision is crucial. The separate elements must line up perfectly. The technical term is one-to-one. An error of only a few thousandths of an inch will become an unsightly matte line several inches across on the big screen. Today's optical printers have improved very little on the eloquence of Dunn's original design, and the machine that made fantasy practical is now the mainstay of every studio effects department. By the late 40s, Hollywood's complacency was being shaken by another wonderful new invention, television. Movies fought back the only way they could, by endeavoring to become as unlike television as possible. The word spectacular took on new meanings every week as new processes and larger format film systems were unveiled. Inevitably, the sudden need for subject matter large enough to fill those new screens brought about the first true boom in science fiction and fantasy filmmaking, the 50s, a time of giant robots, marauding Martians, and a fully employed visual effects community. Harrison Ellenshaw's work as matte painting supervisor on Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back, and The Black Hole reflects the early training he received from his father, Peter Ellenshaw, for years the head of the Disney matte department. With credits dating back to Alexander Korda's Things to Come and Thief of Baghdad, and including 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea, Darby O'Gill and the Little People, Island at the Top of the World, and what may be his masterpiece, Mary Poppins.
This is the Disney matte painting department, and here a number of the paintings are done that are then composited with the live action, the people on the set, the actors, and so forth, and put together and create something that wasn't there originally.
The principles behind matting evolved with the earliest film pioneers, beginning with Méliès' trick of keeping a portion of the frame unexposed for later use. Paintings were generally completed right on the set, positioned before the camera so as to seamlessly extend any shot. That approach is still occasionally employed today, though far more sophisticated techniques have evolved.
Usually paintings are done on a large piece of glass, such as you see right over here, and in this case, this is a matte painting for my science project. And here you see the third story of a high school. The high school only had two stories, yet in the script there was a requirement for a lab up on the third story of the high school. So a matte painting was employed. In this case, you see that particular portion painted on the glass with some of the trees that are actually on location matched into it. And what the artist has done is take a clip of the piece of film shot on the location with the actors and has projected it onto this glass, a little bit of projection material behind it, and then he lines up the painting together with that clip. When that is all finished, the painting is then taken next door where it is composited with the live action for the final shot, and that's right through here. The painting, once it is finished, is brought in here, put on this stand, where it is photographed by this camera. The camera here photographs the matte painting with the live action included in the matte painting. And the live action, those portions of the set with the actors in them, is put into those clear areas in the glass. And as you can see, there's one big clear area there, two on each side, and two smaller clear areas in each of those round balls and the half ball over here on the left. So there are a number of different live action pieces, all cut out and kind of pasted together, combined with the whole painting. This particular shot is from The Black Hole, and in the shot, the people are in an elevator, and as they go out of the elevator, this camera does a move, a pull back from the painting and the live action together, and what you see then is the people in the set combined with the painting. The whole thing is photographed as one with the move generated here.
The late 60s was a time of change for the film industry. The studio system was evolving into a vast corporate empire, and effects-laden films like Fantastic Voyage were becoming harder to justify at the box office. In England, however, producer-director Stanley Kubrick and novelist Arthur C. Clarke were preparing a production that would challenge audiences and visual effects artists for years to come. It was the first big shot for Douglas Trumbull, the man who would go on to design the effects for Close Encounters of the Third Kind. And it was the first time that audiences used to the reality of NASA's pristine imagery could truly experience the feeling of being on location, out there. The film was 2001, A Space Odyssey. 2001 may have been an instant classic, but it was far from being a commercial success, requiring nearly 5 years just to make back its investment. There was, however, the matter of the film's impact on an up-and-coming generation of visual effects designers.
Well, I was younger when 2001 first came out, and I was very affected by it because of its perfection. It was so clean, it was so critically elegant and perfect in every way. And I think it was so good that the ability to do those type of effects, to pull that kind of thing off, was really lost on everybody. It was too much too soon. People didn't know quite how to apply it correctly. And it wasn't until almost 10 years later that Star Wars came along and put something that was commercially viable, combined it with effects, and then we had the success. Until that period of time, we had gone through about 10, 15 years where films were done on location, with the kind of nadir or zenith, depending on your point of view, of that kind of thing being French Connection, where suddenly, with faster film stocks, faster lenses, everybody said, whoa, you don't have to shoot this on the back lot anymore. You can shoot any film you want anywhere in the world on location, existing light conditions in many cases, and whole areas can go dark and light, and it can be very realistic, very gritty. So that took everybody away from the studio. However, when Star Wars came along, that portion of quote-unquote studio magic became very important. And the thought was that it might do James Bond-type business, might do $50 or $60 million, and if it did, everybody would be extremely happy. As it turned out, they were more than happy.
But going in, at least, Lucas was far from certain. In order to succeed within the restrictions levied by an apprehensive 20th century Fox, he would have to churn out nearly twice as many effect shots as 2001, and in less than one-third that film's time and budget. Knowing that no existing Hollywood effects facility was up to the task, he decided to set up shop himself. An empty warehouse next to the Van Nuys Airport would become home to Industrial Light and Magic Incorporated. And when Douglas Trumbull turned down the task of getting it up and running, the offer fell to one of his former protégés, John Dykstra.
One of the hardest parts of doing special effects is coming up with a solution to the problem of the line in the script that says, unlike anything you've ever seen before. We worked for probably 3 months just putting together the group of people that was going to attack the problem. And then once they were assembled, just put it on the table and went after it. And it's the only way you can go after those kinds of things, is aggressively pursue solving the problem. If you sit around and wish for a device that you don't have, or you sit around and wish for a story or a plot ploy of some kind that solves your problems, you'll be wishing from now until you die. The real key to it is to take what you have in terms of storyboards, which is what we had to define what we were going to do, and figure out a way to do it.
If you gave to Oxfam America last year, here's your reward.
The complexity of the space battle scenes Lucas had envisioned would require an equally sophisticated approach in the photography of the miniature spacecraft. The decision was reached to build a motion control system, a robot camera equipped with a computer memory that could store and repeat the most elaborate moves, enabling entire fleets of spacecraft to interact. The system was developed concurrently by Dykstra and Al Miller for Star Wars and Douglas Trumbull for the UFOs of Close Encounters of the Third Kind.
Well, basically, you want to have a moving camera platform. It's been done in the past, many, many years ago, They did what's called matched moves. Basically, it's when you combine two elements of film onto a single element of film to make them appear as though they were photographed at one time. The most simple example is a match shot where you have people in the foreground walking and talking on the ground, and you want to have a giant pumpkin behind them, but you don't have a giant pumpkin. You black out the area above them and paint in the giant pumpkin, and you put those two pieces of film together, and you have what appears to be a giant pumpkin in people. Well, the motion control aspect of it was added when you said, well, I want to pan the camera across the people and the pumpkin. And basically what allows you to do is to take the people, photograph them, remembering your positional displacement per frame, so that if you pan 2 degrees per frame, it remembers that. And then you go shoot the pumpkin, and you pan 2 degrees per frame on the pumpkin. And when you put those two pieces of film together, it appears as though the camera move was made on both of the objects at the same time. That's putting the two elements together with a matched move or motion control.
Unfortunately, not everyone was quite so certain that it would fly. Apogee head of research and development, John Aaron.
There were lots of clashes. Equipment was being built that hadn't existed before, and the people on the producer's side were understandably quite anxious, since nobody was able to say, this, we know this is going to work because it has worked. It was a case of take it on faith, it will work. But I have heard that amongst George's ideas for executing these effects were borrowing techniques from Bunraku puppet theater in Japan, in which you have a blacked out stage and animators basically dressed in black carrying model spaceships on sticks and filming them that way live. That's a nice concept. Unfortunately, it really wasn't going to be sophisticated enough to produce the effects he wanted to see.
George was worried about seeing his dailies with a blue background and not knowing what the results would be in the final composite. Since we had never worked before and we were a bunch of sort of pirates, almost renegades, who didn't have much in the way of big screen credits, and I had to allay his fears in that way.
The blue screen system had fallen into disfavor because of the extraordinary skill it required to achieve a satisfactory result. Again, the versatile optical printer was at the heart of the procedure. Dykstra and Edlin decided to resurrect one of the obsolete film formats of the early 50s. By shooting the models with the larger negative VistaVision camera, they could minimize any grain buildup through the many compositing stages. Once the subject has been photographed against the blue screen, this optically neutral backing can be processed out, leaving the subject on a clear field, ready to be placed against a separately photographed environment. And when you print a blue screen shot onto black and white film, you end up with a set of protection mats, ready to preserve the area of the film in which the subject will ultimately appear. The classic Méliès black area trick continues to pop up in increasingly more sophisticated applications. But even the most impressive shots can stem from a combination of brilliant creativity and inevitable last-minute compromise.
The opening shot in Star Wars was done on a model that was about 40 inches long. We had concepts in mind of building a 50-foot long model for the thing, but by the time we got around to the shot, as you always are confronted with in movie making, the money was getting thin. And I said, let me try the shot, so I did. And I did a test. The test had a little rebel blockade runner that was about maybe an inch and a half long, stuck out in front on a wire just to see how it would look. And it looked fantastic, and after about three or four takes to finesse the thing and get it really perfect, that was the opening shot of the picture. That was one of the most important shots from a visual effects standpoint of the whole series, because if that shot didn't work, you didn't grab the audience on that shot, you may have lost them for the whole series, because first impressions are important.
The effect of Star Wars going through the roof, commercially being so successful, was the mistaken belief by most producers in Hollywood that special effects had made the film successful. And as a result of that, they dusted off all their scripts, called up effects people and said, add some effects to this and we will also have a hit. And as a result, the next 3 years, Hollywood was filled with these Star Wars clones that were not successful and proved the point. It wasn't until Empire Strikes Back came along 3 years later that George Lucas had to go back in and prove that a story was most important and that the first one wasn't just a fluke, that he could still make an effects film that would be successful and have some elegance to it that perhaps some of the others in the meantime did not have.
For this film, Lucas had moved the shop north to San Francisco, where once again, some very old techniques were put to new use.
The walkers were various sizes. We had one walker that was 2 inches tall. Then we had the ones that John Berg and Phil Tippett made for all the stop motion work were about 15 inches tall or so. And for the shots when it fell over, we had a 4 foot tall version. That was shot at high speed. The foot size one was shot as a stop motion approach where you move a frame, shoot a frame, move it a little bit, shoot another frame, etc. The little miniatures that were on the animation stand had to match the horizon, which were out the front window of the speeders as they were approaching the battle. The fact was that by the time we had done Empire, we had gotten so good at motion control programming that we were able to get a lot more verve into that sequence. Instead of programming by numerical curves and making very perfect moves and so on, which are basically uninteresting, when a cameraman is out shooting some sort of action situation, he's likely to bounce around and to actually not make a perfect move. And it looks more human when it's photographed that way. So when we program things, we try to leave a little bit of that inconsistency in there, because even though it's going to be repeated by computer and stored in the memory, and it will be repeated exactly with the little inconsistencies that the programmer put in there, it actually makes for a more interesting pull. Star Wars was fairly conservative in terms of the moves that were made. By the time we got to Empire, we were freer to try ideas and relatively outrageous compositional problems. And also optically, we were much better off in that we had a lot more experience and could put more elements into a shot. We could not have done Empire with the same equipment that we did Star Wars with. In a McLuhan sense, the medium is the message.